Hey everybody, I'm Aslan Hajivandi, joined by managing editor of Warchant.com, the ultimate Seminole sports source, Ira Schofield. We're here to talk about the FSU 2020 schedule for a third time, but this one is going to have all the good bits in it. So hit that thumbs up like button. And if you're not a member of the website, this is the best time to sign up. I truly, sincerely mean that. Ira knows what I'm talking about. Use the promo code, Norvell2020. That gets you 25% off an annual membership, a $25 e-card to Garnet and Gold. So even if you don't live in Tallahassee, you're covered. And our guy Gene Williams said, go ahead, give them three more free months on top of that 25% discount for the annual membership. So join us at warchant.com. A whole lot going on over there. Later on in the day, we'll have interview and reaction from the coaching staff about the schedule and the upcoming season as they do start preseason camp tomorrow. Ira's also going to join Corey and I on the podcast for Friday. So we're busy. We're back. We're back, Ira. We're working again.
You'll be sick of me by Tuesday.
Ah, stop it. Never. All right. Well, let's go ahead and let's take a quick look at the schedule that came out around 9 o'clock this morning. Florida State now knows when they'll play who and where. We already knew those two parts of it. I guess your first reaction, I mean, obviously I would think you probably started towards the top and want to know who they're going to open with. And we see it's going to be Georgia Tech at home. Man, that's about as good as you could ask for, I think. What do you think?
Yeah, especially in this format. You know, we knew it was going to be an ACC game. We felt pretty strongly about that. Gene actually posted on the site earlier that Florida State was going to be opening with a conference game. They wouldn't be opening with Samford. And, you know, if you're going to open with a conference opponent, Georgia Tech's about as good as it gets. And, you know, for Florida State, and I think you've been talking about it a lot during the offseason, about how nice it would be for FSU football to actually get off with a win, to start a season with a win, to get some confidence going early in the season. And I think those first 2 weeks definitely give you that with Georgia Tech and Samford.
Yeah, I think it's been since the Andrew Johnson administration, the Florida State started the season with a win.
And it's not a guarantee. We'll see. But in terms of giving yourself a chance, you know, there's probably maybe three or four teams in the ACC that you really wanted in that spot. Georgia Tech's definitely one of them. Samford, we've been saying for a couple weeks since the schedule got the original schedule got blown up, and we knew there was going to be a revised one. Samford, from what we understand, they expressed very early on that they would meet whatever testing criteria the ACC wanted to play that game. It means that much to them. I think they're getting paid. Well, the original contract was $450,000, so it's worth it to them, even though they're an FCS school, to invest in the testing to make Florida State feel comfortable playing them.
I think that's probably the good we can agree on, right? You got Georgia Tech, which is probably, again, the weakest ACC team on this slate. I mean, you look at their results from last year. It's pretty ugly. I think they might have had three wins. One of them was against USF. You know, they lost in overtime to, I think, an FBS or an FCS program. It was not a good first year for Jeff Collins.
No, it definitely wasn't. I think if you're a Georgia Tech fan, you're hoping that year two, you're catching Florida State in year one under a new coaching staff. They're in year two. But they really, I mean, from everything we've heard, they're going to have to flip the entire roster. I mean, Paul Johnson had been recruiting for one offense. They're going to be doing something different. And, you know, I think the talent level obviously is in Florida State's favor. And you get them at home. Again, it's not, you know, you can't say it's a guaranteed win, but it would be a really tough way for Mike Norvell's era to begin if he lost that opener against Georgia Tech.
Yeah, they lost the Citadel at home in overtime, and they only got a jumper off against Temple. They lost 24-2 against Temple. So, yeah, that's a pretty good way to start the season off there. I guess the bad, if you want to call it that, which I don't necessarily subscribe to, but following those two games, you have Miami on the road, an off week, and then you're on the road again after that against Notre Dame. I guess that's probably the second thing that jumped off at me. Not to be too lazy and go in chronological order, but that's kind of the second that jumped off the screen to me. What do you think about that slate?
Yeah, you know, I mean, I think, and I'm guessing the reason you don't think it's that bad is because, I mean, really, no matter where those games are played, they're probably, if you're doing your preseason W's and L's, you're probably putting in L's. I mean, Miami, it's not because they've beaten Florida State the last couple of years, but it's because of who they brought in. Derek King at quarterback. Their defense is going to be really, really good. Their pass rush is going to be one of the best in the country. And so, you know, with Florida State's problems on the offensive line, it just seems like a tough ask, especially down at Miami. So that was probably going to be a loss. Notre Dame, obviously, that program is, you know, one of the premier programs in the country the last 4 or 5 years. And so you know, that's a game you would not expect Florida State to win on the road. So those are two games you might have lost no matter where they were on the schedule. So you get them back-to-back on the road. You do get the bye week in between. My biggest concern with that stretch is what does it do to you for that home game against North Carolina, because that is a very winnable game, and it's a game you kind of need to win. That's the kind of game, to me, that North Carolina game is the kind of game that differentiates between maybe a 6-5 season or 7-4 season or 7-4 to an 8-3. You know, you don't want those two Miami and Notre Dame games to be so emotional and physical that they cost you that home game against Carolina.
Yeah, good call on that. So then, you know, I guess the rest of the schedule is pretty clear cut here. Louisville is a game on the road. That's one that we feel is probably maybe a coin flip one. Then you get a week off. Pitt comes to town in early November.
That's probably another coin flip, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, for sure. For sure. NC State, I think you feel good about going on the road to play that one. And then to see Clemson this far down on the schedule, I think is kind of a blessing. Oh, wow. That's a little too big there, Anselon. That's what she said. So having it that far down in the schedule, I think is a bit advantageous for Florida State. I mean, it's still Clemson, and you know, what can you really expect out of that contest?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think it's you know, it gives you a chance to, you know, at least gear up for the idea of playing spoiler. You know, if Clemson at that point is rolling, if they're looking like they're going to make another run to the playoff, assuming this season plays out the way it is, and these games actually happen. You know, that could be an opportunity for Florida State to gear up late in the season, kind of give that last big hurrah to try to, you know, ruin Clemson's season. The nice thing about that game is, and I normally wouldn't say this, going on the road to NC State the week before, Florida State has really struggled at NC State through the years. But that is a game, you know, you feel pretty good about Florida State's chances of a road game, Florida State winning at NC State, getting some confidence going into that Clemson game. You know, again, and the other nice thing about that game is it doesn't ruin your season. If you lose it against Clemson, you're not expected to win. And then you finish the year with two very winnable games, two games you have to win, really, in Mike Norvell's first season against Duke and Virginia. And, you know, so I think, if you know, it's about as good as you can ask for, I think, as far as Clemson goes, where it is and when it is.
Yeah, I mean, you know, looking at the schedule, I really – it's kind of hard to really kind of complain about him. I guess what people are sort of griping about is the fact that apparently four teams have an off week before they play Florida State, Clemson being one of them. But it's like, I mean, again, Clemson, I don't know how much time Clemson really needs to prepare for Florida State. it just
if they didn't have that bye week, Florida State would have them on the ropes.
Right.
Yeah, it's Clemson, Notre Dame, Pitt, and Virginia, I believe, have bye weeks before. But I think Florida State has byes before a couple of those.
It's probably going to work out that way with the fact that there's two off weeks and you have, you know, only 11 games in a season. So it's probably going to work out to be that way. But yeah, I don't think Dan Radakovich was on the phone like, hey, like, I need this off week. Dabo said he needs it before Florida State. It just, I mean, ultimately, man, and then you think about, you end with Virginia and Duke. So you probably feel like you're going to end your season on a pretty high note. Those are two games that I feel pretty strongly about that Florida State has a really good shot at winning. For me, the biggest takeaway is you have an entire preseason camp to prepare for maybe the weakest team in the ACC from last season, and then you have an FCS opponent, and then you get to play, you know, your big in-state rival, the state championship, since Florida decided they don't want to play in the sandbox with the big boys this year. That's a really good beginning runway to get this thing, the liftoff, to get the climb started. I mean, that to me is really the biggest takeaway for me, is that Florida State and Mike Norvell's first season gets a really good soft opening, if you will, before he has to face a tough team in Miami.
Yeah, you know, you'd like to start strong and finish strong, and Florida State's going to have the opportunity to do that with this schedule. You know, I think some people are going to look at those games and say, okay, well, you got Georgia Tech and Samford. Maybe you spend some time in camp getting ready for Miami, feeling like you're probably going to win those two games. And maybe I would say that if this was 2015 with Jimbo or if you had a program already in place. But this is Mike Norvell's first season. They didn't have a spring practice. The whole offseason has been a jumble where they've had to, you know, kids couldn't even work out in the facilities until for 2.5-3 months. So this has been the strangest, most bizarre, most challenging offseason, I think you could argue, in college football history, and particularly for a first-year head coach in Mike Norvell. So I got to think he's going to put every effort into winning that Georgia Tech game. That game is huge. You feel like you're going to win Samford the next week. Maybe if you're going to peek ahead to Miami at all, maybe it happens in that week leading up to Samford. But I think Georgia Tech preseason is going to be all about Georgia Tech as much as it can be, because that game is pivotal. They have to start off with a strong, get a strong start and then finish strong, because that middle stretch, I mean, that from Miami to Pitt, I mean, that is a bear. Miami, Notre Dame, North Carolina, Louisville, and Pitt. I mean, I think you're going to win one or two of those games, but that's a tough road.
Yeah, no, that's really good to point out, because, you know, when we first saw the schedule just in terms of who they were going to play where, North Carolina, Louisville, Pitt, those were the games that you kind of put into the coin flip column. Notre Dame probably a little further out odds on that one. And Miami game, I still think doesn't appear to be maybe the best matchup for you, but it is Miami. Crazy, strange things happen in that rivalry. So we will find out soon enough. We now know the schedule in its entirety, who, when, where, all the good stuff. Again, Florida State will start off with Georgia Tech at home, followed by Samford, Miami, and then an off week before they head up to South Bend. So looks pretty good. More reaction to this over on warchant.com. And then Ira, we will be on the virtual conference call with Mike Norvell, assistant coach, as well as selected players later on this afternoon. And we'll have reaction to that and the hopefully the full replay up on our YouTube and Warchant channel. So again, man, the season's here.
Yeah, and also keep checking back to warchant.com, because we'll have information about ticketing, how many tickets are going to be sold, how you can get them. All that information should be coming soon as well. And stay connected to warchant.com.
What do we think? 20-ish, 20, 25% capacity?
The number I had heard a while ago was about 18,000, and I think that's probably where it's going to end up be, somewhere in that ballpark. I'd be surprised if they aimed much higher than that.
All right, very well. Again, use that promo code Norvell2020 if you're not a member of warchant.com. 25% off an annual membership, 3 free months tacked on top of that, and then a $25 e-card to guardiangold.com. So now's the time to join. Start the climb with us. Ira, thanks for your time, man.
Thanks, Aslan. Take care.